بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وأفضل الصلاة وأزكى التسليم على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Welcome to the Hadith class. Today inshallah we are continuing discussing the Sunan of Abi Dawud رحمه الله, and we are still in the book of Sunnah. We will take some ahadith today, inshallah, from the book of Sunnah, and then we will move to the last chapter of the book, which is Kitab al-Adab. The first hadith we have for today in Kitab al-Sunnah is the hadith that is narrated by Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma. Narrated Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam used to seek refuge in Allah for al-Hasan and al-Husayn, saying, I seek refuge for both of you in the perfect words of Allah from every devil and every poisonous thing and from the evil eye which influences. He would then say, your father sought refuge in Allah by them for Ismail and Ishaq. أُعِيذُكُمَا بِكَلِمَاتِ اللَّهِ التَّامَّةِ مِنْ كُلِّ شَيْطَانٍ وَهَامَّ وَمِنْ كُلِّ عَيْنٍ لَامَّةِ. That is the dua that the Prophet ﷺ used to do for Ismail, for Al-Hasan and Al-Husayn. And there are many lessons in this hadith. Al-Hasan and Al-Husayn are the grandsons of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, but not from his son, from his daughter. In Arabic, the name of the grandsons from the daughter's side is Sibt. The grandson is called Sibt, and the plural is Asbat. While from the other side, Hafid and Ahfad. So Al-Hasan and Al-Husayn are the grandsons of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam from his daughter Fatima radiallahu anha. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that they are the leaders of the youth in paradise. Al-Hasan and Al-Husayn, Sayyida Shabab Ahli Al-Jannah. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam gave them the glad tidings of paradise. And he used to love them a lot. And one time Al-Hasan radiallahu anh, he was climbing the pulpit of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, my son is the leader. إِنَّ ابْنِي هَذَا سَيِّد وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ سَيُصْلِحُ عَلَى يَدَيْهِ بَيْنَ فِئَتَيْنَ عَظِيمَتَيْنَ. And Allah will consolidate, will fix the matter between two great groups of Muslims on his hands. And that happened in the time of Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, because of the fighting between Ali radiallahu anhu and Muawiyah radiallahu anhu. Then Al-Hasan agreed for truce, and the matter became good for all Muslims. Here in this hadith, first of all, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is seeking refuge with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for them. And that's the job of the father, of the grandfather. Many times nowadays you think that you only give them money, you only help them with food, with clothes, with things. That's good, but that's not everything. This is more important. Look at the protection of the Prophet ﷺ and look how he cared about his grandsons. So he used to seek refuge with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for them. And usually in Arabic, when you say the dua, it is recommended to be said in Arabic. That's why I don't like to say any translated dua unless you cannot do it in Arabic. So try to memorize it in Arabic, because the dhikr is specific, just like the Quran. You cannot recite it translated. The translation is not Quran. It is a translation. And the same thing for dua, also for this protection. Try always to say it in Arabic. If you cannot, then you say it in English. But in Arabic, أَعُوذُ بِكَلِمَاتِ اللَّهِ التَّامَّ مِنْ كُلِّ شَيْطَانٍ وَهَامَّ وَمِنْ كُلِّ عَيْنٍ لَامَّ. هَامَّ, any poisonous insect, any poisonous animal. So the Prophet ﷺ used to seek refuge with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for Al-Hasan and Al-Husayn. In this hadith, we learn that it is permissible to seek refuge for other people. If they cannot, or if they asked you, that is permissible. Who's better than the Prophet ﷺ to pray for you, for your protection? Here in this hadith, we learn that it is permissible. We took also another hadith when the Prophet ﷺ was unable to wipe over his body. He used to ask Aisha radiallahu anha, and she used to wipe over the body of the Messenger ﷺ. So this is permissible. Another great thing in this hadith, that this was also the norm of Ibrahim alayhi salam. He used also to seek protection for his children, for Ismail and Ishaq. And in this hadith, very beautiful thing that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and his grandsons are from the progeny of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, your father. And we learn from this, it is permissible to say for your great-great-grandfather, a father, because he is a father, but he is a far father. So it is permissible to say to your great-grandfather, a father. Now, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "U'idhukuma bi kalimati Allahi tamma," with the perfect words of Allah. What is the perfect word of Allah? The Prophet ﷺ is seeking protection for his children with the perfect words of Allah. So he's seeking protection through what? What are the perfect words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The Quran, exactly. It is the Quran. What's the evidence? Allah says in the Quran, وَتَمَّتْ كَلِمَةُ رَبِّكَ صِدْقًا وَعَدْلًا. And the word of your Lord is perfected in truth and in justice. So what are the perfect words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The Quran. The most important lesson in this hadith is about the Quran itself. And that's why Imam Abu Dawud rahimahullah mentioned this hadith here in this chapter. Are the Quran, the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, are they created or not? Are the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created or not? Answer me. The Quran. Khalil, is the Quran created or not? So it is creator? It's not created and it's not creator. How then? It's the words of the Creator. Are they created, the words of the Creator? That's the reason why Abu Dawud rahimahullah mentioned this hadith here. One of the most famous teachers of Abu Dawud rahimahullah is who? You forgot? Imam Ahmad rahimahullah. And Imam Ahmad, he was tested and he was tried through that question, that particular question. Is the Quran created or not? Because some people came and they said, either you say it is created or you say it is creator. There is no in between. So when you say it is the words of God, okay, fine. Is it created? Are the words of God created? Yes or no? No? Are the words of God something or not? Or nothing? They are something. How do you answer then when someone reads the ayah, Allahu khaliqu kulli shay? Allah is indeed the creator of everything. Everything, does it include the Quran or not? Allah is saying, Allahu khaliqu kulli shay. Allah is the creator of everything. What do you think? You have to be very careful and you have to know what to answer, because an entire group of Muslims deviated and established a sect based on that. Yes?
It's the speech of Allah, so it's from Allah still, so it can't be created.
But is it something or not?
It is something, but it's not.
If it's something, then how come you say it is not created? We say it is something, but not like other things. Just like when you exclude something, and there are many examples in the Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, it destroys everything. Did it really destroy everything? Allah later on says, except for the houses. So yes, Allah is creator of everything. But the Quran is something, but not like other things. The Quran is the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it is not created. How can you seek refuge with the created? Can you seek refuge with the created person or object? That is shirk. If you seek refuge with, and you say, I seek refuge with this, that is shirk, kufr. No, it is not shirk. What do you think?
I call it belief as a comfort.
No, that's not what we're talking about. Isti'adha, the true isti'adha, when you seek refuge and protection from things that are not tangible. That is shirk. But in the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ sought protection through the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which means the words of Allah are not created. It is from Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, let me ask you this. Then what do you say about, what is this? Quran. Is it created or not? Isn't this paper?
Yes.
Thick paper? Is it created or not?
Yes.
What about here inside? Is it created or not?
These are written words.
When you recite the Quran.
The ink that is used to write.
Yes. Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, he used to say, whoever said the Quran is created has committed disbelief. And whoever said the Quran is not created, he committed a bid'ah. So what do you do then? The question itself is wrong, actually. Because the Quran is the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The voice that we say, this is from ourselves, and we are created. Yes, my voice is created. This book, the book itself, the paper, the ink, yes, it is created. But not the words. The words are from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is very important. Yes.
If the last statement about the word that come out of your mouth, isn't that what Imam Bukhari said, and they didn't like that?
Yeah, it is not liked. Again, but you have to make this distinction. You have to make this distinction when you say the Quran is not created. What do you mean? My voice? Yes, my voice is created. As I told you, the question itself is wrong. You don't ask this question. And many scholars, including Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, were tested and tried because of that. Okay, so this is the first hadith about the Quran. The next hadith, we have it in the chapter on the killing of the Khawarij. Who are the Khawarij? The group that deviated from Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. And they accused Ali radiallahu anhu of disbelief. And they became very, very extreme people. They became very extreme people. The hadith we have is from Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu, reported the Apostle of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam as saying, he who separates from the community within a span takes off the noose of Islam from his neck. Yarhamukumullah. Man faraqa al-Islam qida shibrin فَقَدْ خَلَعَ رِبْقَةَ الْإِسْلَامِ مِنْ عُنُقِهِ. Whoever separates from the community within a span takes off the noose of Islam from his neck. Why Abu Dawud rahimahullah mentioned this hadith under that chapter, killing of the Khawarij? Because they deviated. So, he wanted to tell you that the Khawarij, they separated from the community. This is one thing. And all scholars agreed that the Khawarij, they went astray from the correct path. This is one thing. The other thing, what constitutes community in this hadith, or jama'ah? That's what the Prophet ﷺ said, jama'ah. Alaykum bil jama'ah. Behold to the community. What's the community here? What do you say? Nowadays, we have Islamic Society of Greater Houston. Is that the community? In some places, you have 5, 6, 7 masjids. All of them follow one group. But that group allows same-sex marriage, allows drinking alcohol. And then there is only one masjid. where people pray five times a day and they say alcohol is forbidden and we forbid what Allah and His Messenger forbid. So what constitutes community? The number, the beauty of the people, the money that they have, or what? What is the community? The community is whoever followed the book of Allah and the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's the meaning of the community. Even if it was only one person, even if it was one person, that is the community. And actually, some scholars were asked, which community, where is the community, which one should we follow? So they were told, follow that person, he is the community, although he was only one individual. Why? Because he was on the correct path. That's what you follow. And that's the community. Now, what about the one who leaves the community? Is he a disbeliever or not? Another question, are the Khawarij disbelievers or not? They're not? Why? Don't you read the Prophet ﷺ, what did he say? If you leave the community within a span, you took off the noose of Islam from your neck. What about if you leave the community 10 miles? If you leave it only one span, what do you learn from this if you leave it one span? Always stick to the community. Division is always evil. Do not divide the community. Do not divide people. And that's why we have many ayat, many ahadith. The Prophet ﷺ said, even if you were only three people, appoint someone as a leader. Why? Because we don't want division in the community. So in this hadith, are the Khawarij kuffar or not? Actually, some scholars said yes. The Prophet ﷺ said they are the dogs of the fire, hum kilabu nar. And he himself said that they penetrate through the religion just like the arrow penetrates through the prey. But again, it went inside and left. So the Khawarij are what? According to this, some scholars said kuffar, but many other scholars said no, they are not kuffar. Ali radiallahu anhu was asked about al-Khawarij. He said they fled from disbelief. The Prophet ﷺ said, you, to the companions, you will belittle your prayer compared to their prayer. So again, are they kuffar or not? In this hadith, again, do you take it literally? So whoever left the jama'ah, someone deserted the community of Muslims, he's not kafir, but he's not also in the protection. So he's subject to deviation, to disbelief. That's the meaning when he took off the noose of Islam from his neck. Not necessarily that everyone who left the jama'ah with span that he's a disbeliever. That's how you should understand this hadith. So this is the hadith that we have about al-Khawarij. The next we have is the Book of Adab. The Book of Adab. And again, Sunan Abi Dawud rahimahullah should include only the chapters of fiqh. But sometimes they include also other things that are needed, such like the Book of Adab. It's one of the biggest chapters in the Book of Sunan Abi Dawud rahimahullah. Why? Because it is important. As a Muslim, how can you apply fiqh? How can you do all other things? You need adab. What is adab? What's the definition of adab? What's the meaning of adab? Good morals. That's one of the definitions. What else? Some scholars said, using what is praised of sayings and actions. Anything that if you said, people will praise you. Or any action, if you said, people will commend you. استعمال ما يحمد قولا أو فعلا. That's what some scholars said about adab. Another definition, just like what Hashim said, being on a good character. Other scholars said, الوقوف عند المحمود عند الفضائل. Stopping at the recommended things, which means you don't transgress beyond that. You always do what is recommended. you leave what is disputed. This is another thing. And lastly, some scholars said, adab is to honor who's above you. Tawqiru man huwa fawqak wa idharu al-rahmati liman huwa dunak. If someone is better than you in knowledge, in age, in rank, you honor him. If he's below you in age, in knowledge, in anything, you show mercy to him. These are various definitions for adab. Honoring who's above you and showing mercy to who's below you. The first hadith we have is the first hadith in the chapter itself, which is hadith Anas radiallahu anhu. Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu said, the Apostle of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was one of the best of men in character. Actually, in Arabic, kana ahsan anas. He was the best of men in character. That's it. I don't know why they add few words. Was one of the best. He was the best man in character. One day, now Anas radiallahu anhu is telling you that the Prophet ﷺ is the best man. Then he is telling you why. Why? He is giving you one story. He said, one day, he sent me to do something. And I said, I swear by Allah that I will not go. And actually, this is also a mistranslation, because in the Arabic text, he said, in my intention, I will not go. That was his intention. He did not tell the Prophet ﷺ, by Allah, I will not go. The companions would never do that. So even the Arabic, it is wrong. In the English translation, it is translated by mistake. I swear by Allah that I will not go. In my intention, that's what he said. In my intention, I was intending not to go. But in my heart, I felt that I should go to do what the Prophet ﷺ had commanded me. So I went out. The Prophet ﷺ told him to go to do something. And at the beginning, he said, I will not go. Then he went out. But what happened? I came upon some boys who were playing in the street. Now Anas radiallahu anhu, he was a young boy. When the Prophet ﷺ came to Medina, he was only 10 years old. So if this hadith was after 3-4 years of hijrah, that means he was only 14, teenager. He saw some boys playing, so what happened? He played with them. What about what the Prophet ﷺ sent him for? All of a sudden, Apostle of Allah ﷺ, who had come up behind, caught me by the back of the neck. From here. By the back of the neck. And when I looked at him, he was what? Laughing. He was laughing. Can you do that? Usually, if someone did something against what you wanted, what do you do? At least you frown in his face. But the Prophet ﷺ was laughing. Laughing means smiling. The Prophet ﷺ's laugh is smiling only. So he was laughing. He said, what did he say, the Prophet ﷺ? Go where I ordered you, little Anas. اذهب حيث أمرتك أنيس. أنيس is little Anas. عمير is little عمير. أسيد is little أسد. And this is a form of showing love to the person that you're talking to. Just like when you say, how are you, little girl, or how are you doing? The same thing. Ya Aba Umair, ma fa'ala nughair. And that's the style of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He would make people love him. Again, Anas did not do what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him to do. And instead of being upset, instead of telling him, don't you understand what's wrong with you, he told him, go where I asked you to go, little Anas. Little Anas. Just like when someone calls you with the best name you like to be called with. That's what the Prophet ﷺ did here. I replied, yes, I am going, Apostle of Allah. I will go. Anas said, I swear by Allah, I served him. Means I served the Messenger ﷺ for 7 or 9 years. In the narration of Abu Dawood, there is doubt, 7 or 9 years. But in the narration of Imam Muslim, because this hadith is authentic, it is narrated by Imam Muslim, rahimahullah, it came clearly 9 years. Anas radiallahu anhu served the Messenger for 9 years. He swore by Allah that within those 9 years, he never said to me about a thing which I had done. Why did you do such and such? He asked me to do something and I did it the wrong way. He never told me why you did it such and such. Nor about a thing which I left, something that he told me to do and I did not do. Why did you not do such and such? For 9 years, never the Prophet ﷺ told Anas radiallahu anhu, why did you do it? Because he was not supposed to do it. Or why didn't you do it? Because he was supposed to do it. Never. Only this quality of the Messenger ﷺ is enough to consider him the greatest of all men. Can you do that? For 1 week. Can you do that? Let's start with your spouse. Can you do that? With the weekend, actually, we have a competition and we will see. Whoever is married and he did not tell his wife or his husband for a week, why? If she did something wrong, why did you do it? Or she did not do something that he wanted her to do, why did you do it? He will have $50. Can you do it? For 9 years, the Prophet ﷺ did not tell Anas. Now remember, this is only one incident. One incident. The Prophet ﷺ asked him to go, to do something. What do you think the Prophet ﷺ would ask someone to do for him? Something silly, something not important. He's the Messenger of Allah. Definitely what he asked him to do, something that is needed to be done. Yet Anas forgot. He was playing. He got busy with the kids playing. The Prophet ﷺ came. He took him from the back of his neck. He smiled and he told him, go where I asked you to go, little Anas. He did not frown in his face. He did not yell at him. He did not tell him, what's wrong with you? How many times I tell you, come on, it is important for me. And he never said this. He never. Can you do that? This is only one quality of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam in one incident. So let's try to do this, inshallah. Just for 1 week. Don't tell the people, why didn't you do it? If you ask them to do something and they did not do it. Or, why you did it this way, if you wanted it the other way. How about 1 hour? 2 hours? Half a day? Let's see. This is your homework, inshallah, and we will see next week. With this, we will conclude the session of hadith for today, inshallah. Is there any questions about the ahadith that are mentioned? We took only 3 ahadith today. Any questions? Question says, do we have khawarij nowadays? Yes, we do. In some parts of the world, there are some khawarij. However, as a systematic group, we may not have like the old days. We have some group, you trace their ancestry, it goes all the way back to the khawarij. Some of them are in Oman. Some of them are in Algeria. Very few groups of people, but they are different than the other khawarij. But we have some people, they have the same methodology of al-khawarij. Basically, any sin that you do or you commit, that is disbelief, or it is a major sin, and you have to be killed or you have to be punished. We have some people with that mentality. And inshallah, we'll study their theology, their mindset next semester in Aqidah, inshallah. Another question says, when the Prophet ﷺ gave the glad tidings to Al-Hasan and Al-Husayn. Does that mean this is a prophecy that they will die young? Maybe. It is possible. Because they both died young. Any other questions? Okay. هذا وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى صحبه اجمعين. السلام عليكم ورحمه الله.